right, good evening to you. So tonight, you can go from 326 through 350. Although, Scott Long says there's so many good ones, we're going to have to do these same numbers again next week. We'll find out. All right, we're going to start with the hard one. We'll start with 328.
And I'll even switch to the lead on the high part.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you. All right, so we're going to do 328. Which verses are we going to do, Scott? What verse is here? Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song. Which verses, Courtney?
1 and 5.
So 1 and 5? Or one, okay. Did I hear somebody saying 1 and 6? In which verses?
Oh, wonderful Savior is Jesus, my
Which verses? I don't know if it's just the practice, but y'all are sounding better than you did a few weeks ago. 346. Which verses you want to sing, Cheryl? He's got the You do know this one. Which verses you want to sing, Troy? 344. Jesus loves me, this I know. Yes, Jesus. I don't think I've ever played this song before.
Oh, that ain't the right one.
that's good.
She was standing on the clock.
3:35. I do know this one. Promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Do that one? We did. We don't do two at the same each in a service. If nobody's going to ask for, which one did I see? Nobody's going to ask for 342, then I'm going to ask for it. So let's sing 342.
I would have, but I'd already put it in my.
You got to put in an extra dollar if you want a second request. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin. Not the labor. Last call. Anything else? Last call in church means something different than it does other places. Just so you know. All right, y'all, that was good singing tonight. I saw Blanche look confused. That's why I had to clarify that. All right, I'm going to ask you a hard question here. Did everybody get one? I put them at the back this time. I tricked you all. Are there enough? I made 40. I don't know how many are here. Looks like it. All right, so here's the hard question I have for you. Let's say there's a new believer that you get to know, and they find out that you've been a believer for a while, and so they ask you, if they said, what's the one thing I need to do to grow as a Christian, what would you tell them? If they just ask for one thing, what are you going to tell them that they must do to grow as a Christian? Okay, read the Bible. What'd you say, Blanche?
Faith.
What, have faith? Have faith, okay. What else?
Memorize Scripture.
Oh, memorize Scripture, that's good.
Pray.
Fellowship other Christians. Is that it? Anybody tell them something different?
How about believe?
Believe? You get the gold star tonight, Dan. That's what our whole lesson's about. Maybe you were reading ahead. Believe. Ooh. Find a church. Do you want me to put that up here, Kenny? Is that what you're suggesting? Make a casserole? A peach cobbler? All right, so we've been talking about that the Christian walk consists of two repeated steps, repentance and faith. Repentance and faith. We've seen that most of the weeks that we've been doing this together. Once again, that's the emphasis this week. Will you turn to Mark chapter 1 in your Bibles? Mark chapter 1. Last week in particular, we looked at repentance. This week, we're going to look at the other side, faith, and how to make it concrete. So in Mark chapter 1, will somebody... You know what? Actually, since it's just one verse, I'm going to read it, so I don't have to get a microphone yet. So Mark chapter 1, verse 15, it says... Well, let me start back in verse 14. After John was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Repent and believe the good news. If Jesus had a bumper sticker, I think that's what it would say. It would say, repent and believe. That was a tagline for him throughout his teaching ministry. So what do you think Jesus means? Or what did he mean by repent and believe? What was he calling people to? What, Abby? Okay, turn away from your sin. Okay, and believe that he can cleanse you from those sins. Yeah.
To acknowledge
Okay, that's part of it, definitely. Acknowledge you have sinned. That's involved in repentance. Anything else you think that he meant with repent and believe? Oh, he was calling them to change, definitely. Okay, yeah, turning your hearts back to God. And what exactly are we to believe? Look back at verse 15. What does he say you're supposed to believe? Believe the good news. Which, okay, so when we hear the word good news, we think about the gospel and everything about Jesus. When he said those words at the start of his ministry, what did that mean? Because they didn't know about the death and resurrection of Jesus. So what did he mean by repent and believe the good news? Yeah, I think you're right, Scott. And I think we see that at the first half of verse 15. He says the time is fulfilled. And that's what he's talking about. All the things from the Old Testament prophets. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is near. That's the good news. The kingdom of God is near. So the article we're going to read tonight focuses on what it means to believe the gospel and how that produces growth in our lives. Let me grab a microphone. Roger, I'm going with, is white okay? All right, so we're going to read the article through like we normally do, paragraph at a time. Where should I go? I'm going to go back over this way this time. All right, who will start reading for us? Thank you, Daniel.
Over the past few weeks, we have said that repentance and faith should be the continued, consistent pattern of the Christian life. Last week, we examined the nature of true repentance. This week, we want to dive deeper into the subject of faith.
Think for a moment about this question. What one thing should I do to grow more as a Christian? If someone asked you that question, how would you respond? Would you suggest some basic spiritual discipline, such as reading the Bible, praying, finding Christian friends, repenting of sin, or learning theology?
The crowds brought this exact query to Jesus in John 6. His answer may surprise you. Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works of God that God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent."
Notice they are asking Jesus what they must do to live a life that pleases God. Jesus answers that the work of God is to believe. In other words, the Christian life is not about doing, it is about believing. Getting this right is crucial to sanctification. Most of us are naturally doers. We gladly embrace the next project, the next challenge, the next assignment. So our pursuit of Christian maturity produces a lot of busy effort, but little lasting change. Why is this so? Because we are doing too much and believing too little.
You see, our surface sins are only symptoms of a deeper problem. Underneath every external sin is a heart idol, a false god that has eclipsed the true God in our thoughts or affections. To paraphrase Martin Luther, every sin is in some way a breaking of the first commandment, "You shall have no other gods before me." Luther wrote, "As the first commandment is the very first, highest, and best, from which all others proceed, so also its work, that is, faith or confidence in God's favor at all times, is the very first, highest, and best, from which all other works must proceed, exist, remain, be directed, and measured." In other words, keeping God primary is a foundational to spiritual growth. The key to gospel-driven transformation is learning to repent of the sin beneath the sin, the deeply rooted idolatry and unbelief that drive our more visible sins.
As a case study, let's take the surface sin of gossip, talking about people behind their backs in judgmental or destructive ways. Why do we gossip? What are we looking for that we should be finding in God?
Here are some of the common heart idols that can manifest themselves in the surface sin of gossip. The idol of approval. I want the approval of the people I'm talking to. The idol of control. Using gossip as a way to manipulate others. The idol of reputation. I want to feel important, so I cut someone else down verbally. The idol of success. Someone is succeeding and I'm not. The idol of security. Talking about others masks my own insecurity. The idol of pleasure. Someone else is enjoying life and I'm not, so I attack her. The idol of knowledge. Talking about people is a way of showing I know more. The idol of recognition. Talking about others gets people to notice me. The idol of respect. That person disrespected me, so I'm going to disrespect him.
All these idols are false saviors promoting false gospels. Every one of these things, approval, control, reputation, success, security, pleasure, knowledge, recognition, respect, is something we already have in Jesus because of the gospel. But when we are not living in light of the gospel, we turn to these idols to give us what only Jesus can truly give us.
Another way to identify your particular heart idols is to ask, what do I love, trust, or fear? For example, if I fear being single, being in a relationship will probably be my idol because it promises to deliver me from the hell of singleness. If I trust having enough security will probably be my idol because it promises that I'll never be without anything. If I love order and structure, control will probably be my idol because if I'm in charge, I can make sure things are in order.
Reflecting on the sin beneath our sin shows why the gospel is essential for true heart change. It's possible to repent of surface sins for a lifetime, yet never address the deeper heart issues behind them. At the moment I sin, I have already broken the first commandment. An idol has taken God's place in my soul. I am trusting in that idol rather than in God to be my Savior. I need to apply the gospel by repenting of my deep heart idolatry and believing, that is, turning my mind toward the specific gospel promises that break the power of my characteristic idols.
According to Dr. Steve Childers, faith involves learning how to set the afflictions of our mind and our heart on Christ. Faith requires a continual rehearsing and delighting in the many privileges that are now ours in Christ. Notice the two aspects of faith, setting our affections on Christ and delighting in the privileges that are ours in Christ. I must worship Jesus, not my idols, and I must remind myself of what really, truly about me because of faith.
Let's go back again to our example of gossip. Let's imagine that I've identified respect as the dominant idol that drives me to gossip. After I acknowledge my sin and repent of it, I exercise faith in two ways. First, I pause and worship Jesus because he laid aside his right to be rejected, becoming humbled to the point of death. Second, I remind myself of the gospel truth that I no longer need to crave the respect of others because I have the approval of God through faith in Jesus. Whether people respect me or not is immaterial. God's grace had freed me from demanding my own respect, and now I live for the fame and honor of Jesus.
This exercise is fairly simple in the abstract, but it can be much more difficult when thinking through your own personal patterns of sin. So set aside some intentional time to, one, identify your common surface sins, and two, prayerfully consider what heart idols might lie behind them. Then three, worship Jesus for his victory over that idol. And four, find specific gospel promises you can rely on to help defeat the power of that idol. Be sure to invite others into your process of reflection and repentance. As one writer has put it, you can't see your own face. We need each other in order to see our sin clearly and deal with it honestly.
As you learn to live a gospel-centered life, remember, this is the essence of walking with Jesus. Repentance and faith are not steps on the path. They are the path. The work of God is to believe.
As we were reading through that, was there anything that caught your eye, caught your attention, that sounded significant and important? Yeah. Which is why we can call all sin idolatry. Because we're putting something else other than God as our God. What were you going to say, Abby? Oh, wasn't Abby, it was Courtney.
The last one, repentance and faith are not steps on the path to life. The work of God is to believe.
So back on the first page with John 6, 28 and 29, when people ask Jesus, what works do we need to be doing to be right with God? He says, the work of God is to believe. To believe specifically in him, in Jesus, and the one he sent. That's God's work, is to believe. I love how he says, the Christian life is not about doing. It's about believing. But for many of us, we're doing too much and believing too little. Anything else you noticed in there? Yeah, that's right. That's good. Anything else?
We have to be real. We can't just be surface. We have to go deeper to the root of the sin, not just the...
Okay, getting down to the root of the sin. And that's a great segue, Richard. That's what we're going to spend the rest of our time on. So on the back, so at the very end of the article, it talked about taking some time to reflect and uncover. So you have we can call them this way, we're going to call it a fruit sin. So what everybody sees, so whether, you know, your anger or what else, or slander, like the sins that everybody gets to see. But underneath all of those, there are roots that produce that sin. And so the work of reflection is to figure out what is the root underneath this sin, the fruit sin that everybody can see. And that's, so you have this chart here, and I encourage you to make some notes on it as we go. So on the left side of the chart where it says the lies I believe, we're going to start at the top, and I just want you to know that there are going to be lies all the way down. So you'll see the fruit sin, and then there's going to be a lie about who you are, why you participate in that sin. There's going to be a lie about what God has done, and then who God is. So there's going to be lies about things all on the left side, and then on the right side, we replace the truth, replace the lie with the truth. So let's take, we're just going to take a few examples. Let's start with cussing, okay? I have a couple of friends who've been believers various amounts of time and have told me from time to time that they still have problems sometimes, and their mouth just runs off and runs away with them. So the fruit sin, the sin they're dealing with, so you can do this along with me on your paper. don't take up the whole space because we're going to go through this a couple of different times. So if cussing is their issue, one thing that the article points out to us, it, all those different idols, approval, control, reputation, there could be different reasons why a person cusses. So the first thing you have to ask is, so when I cuss, what does that say about who I believe I am? What does that say about who I believe I am? And so you could go different ways here. We'll go a couple of different ways. So you one thing you could say is, the reason you're cussing is because something happened and I deserve better. And I'm upset that I didn't get what I deserve. Okay, so let's go that way. So the who I am is, I'm important and I deserve better. That's the reason I'm cussing, because I believe that I deserve better. So then the next thing you have to ask to get further down to the root, so what is the sin of cussing, because I believe I deserve better, what does that say about my belief about God? What does that sin say about what I believe about God in that moment? That's right. God isn't giving me what I deserve. He's holding out on me. So do you see how your belief and what you think God has done or hasn't done is producing this in you? So maybe God's holding out on me. He hasn't done what he's supposed to do. Which, if that's what you think about God, what does that say about who you believe God to be? What'd you say, Courtney?
We don't trust him.
Okay, we don't trust him. Maybe we believe, because it's we believe that he's harsh or he isn't good. He hasn't been good. He must not be a good God. Okay. Okay, so that could be a different way. Yeah, another way that you're going. You could think of God as in a relationship of a, like a landlord and a tenant. Yeah, God's holding out, so he's not good. God is not good. So the fruit sin was cussing. You cuss in that moment because something didn't go your way. The root that's underneath it is that in that moment, you don't believe God is good. You're not focusing on that belief, that truth. You've replaced the truth with a lie. So what you have to do then is come to the other side and work your way back up with the truth. I guess we could write lies and truth up here. So what is true about God?
He is good.
He is good. Is there any place in Scripture that says that God is good? Anybody think of one in particular? There's a song. Is that song based on anything? Okay, well, let's actually step up to the next one. Maybe this will help us. So what has God done that proves to us that he is good? He sent Jesus and he died for us. He gave sacrificially to us. So what did he do? He gave sacrificially. It proves his goodness. So now, because you are people that have been changed by God, adopted into his family, what is true about you, about who you are, based on what God did for you? What is true of you? In contrast to over here, I deserve better. Okay, what did you say? Yeah, we were bought with a high price. And what Richard just said, we don't deserve God's goodness at all. Everything that we have received is more than we deserve. So we're not, it's not that we deserve better,
It's that we've gotten more than we deserve. We've gotten better than we deserved. Better than we deserve. So then, how should that change? What would the Holy Spirit, how would he lead you to respond in that moment? Instead of cussing, how would the Holy Spirit lead you to respond? Okay. Well, let's say you hit your thumb with a hammer, and that's why you cussed. What would the Holy Spirit lead you to do in that moment? You still hit your thumb with a hammer. It still hurts.
At least I got a thumb. My deceased husband, who was just, well, anyway. When we first got married, we went on a little road trip, and he was driving my vehicle, unknown. He wasn't used to the vehicle. He gets out, slams the door on his thumb.
There is something to be grateful for. Yeah, and even if everything in the situation is bad, you still have all of this. God has already proved his goodness for you, and that while you were a sinner, Jesus died for you, and you've gotten way better than you deserve. So yeah, and a spirit of gratitude. How else might the Holy Spirit lead you to respond instead of cussing? Okay. And why can we do that? What's one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit? Self-control is a gift of the Holy Spirit. That's right. So he can give you the self-control you need in that moment. Okay, so let's do another fruit sin, discover the root, and then discover the way that God would lead us out of it. Let's take a sin of addiction. I think you could do this with any addiction, but we're going to go with pornography. That's a major problem in our country and in our churches. So, even among Christians. So let's figure out what is going on at the root of that. Okay, so the fruit sin is pornography. So what does that say about a person or about, what does that say that they believe about themselves when they look at pornography? What are they saying they believe about themselves? Why do people look at pornography?
What God has blessed you with isn't good enough.
Okay, what God has given me isn't enough. My pleasure is supreme. That's the most important thing to me. We could go either one of those ways. Let's go, since we just did a sort of I deserve better, let's go with the pleasure side. So my pleasure is supreme. So what does that say about what that person believes about what God has done or what he hasn't done for them? God hasn't done enough for me. He hasn't provided what I need. So I've got to go take care of this myself. So how would I say that? Okay. Okay. That's okay. We'll keep going. God's gifts aren't enough. So then, what does that say about, what is that person believing about who God actually is in that moment? Okay, that God can't satisfy me, or he won't satisfy me. God can't satisfy me. And so that you could go either way. Like, so either God's not powerful enough, like this is an area that he doesn't have control over. So let's go that way. So God isn't capable of satisfying me in this area. Yeah, like he's not powerful enough to bring me a spouse, or he's not powerful enough to get my spouse to change in the ways that I want. God's not powerful enough in this area. So if he's not going to come through, then I'm going to, this is the fruit sin. This is a sin that's evident, it's outward, but this is what's going on, could be going on in the heart. So there is, with all of these, this whole thing is repentance. It's recognizing what is actually at the bottom so that you can repent and turn from your sin and walk back toward Jesus. And this is the belief side. So this is the repent, is you deconstruct what's going, get all the way down to the bottom. And then this is, I'm going to build my belief back up. So let's go with the bottom of the truth about who God is, in contrast to God's not powerful enough to meet my needs. That's right. God is all powerful. He owns everything. He commands everyone. How has God shown that he is all powerful and that he can provide everything that anyone needs? What has he done to show that? Okay, creation. Creation itself. Everything we have and enjoy came from God. He invented it. Even in this case, sexual desire is a gift of God. It's a creation of God. Okay, so with God as all-powerful and as the one who created all of this, what does that say about who we are? Well, we are self over here. Yeah, my pleasure is supreme. That's selfishness. But on this side, a spirit led, who are we? What did y'all say before Troy distracted me? Okay, we belong to God. We belong to God. Do you see the difference in motivation between my pleasure is supreme, I get to decide what I'm going to do, versus I belong to God. He's the one who gets to decide what I'm going to do. I'm going to submit to him. That contrast there. So then, what would a spirit-led response be in the area of sexual desire rather than looking at pornography? What would God's spirit lead you to do? Okay, so if you're single, if you're not married yet, that's going to be a matter of, I'm going to trust God and wait for his provision. If you're married, what is it? What's a spirit-led response? Okay, yeah, I'm going to thank God for the gift that he's given. Anything else? Okay. That's great, Nick, that the Holy Spirit would definitely lead you to communicate with your spouse. And with your spouse, I think with a spouse, you should say, here's where I'm being tempted. This is, and work down with them to what's underneath, and then figure out what is a spirit-led response that's based on the truth of who God is, that we can trust God rather than, we can trust that God has a plan, he has the power to provide what we need, rather than going and getting it ourselves. Okay, yeah, enjoying the gift that God gave you. Now, this right here, it takes some practice. It's not always easy to figure it out, to get from here to here. It's really helpful to have somebody to brainstorm with and do that. This part is also, whenever you get to the what has God done, looking for specific examples in Scripture is super helpful. Right here. Now, because it's 7 o'clock, we're going to pause this, and next week when we start, we're going to start with this, and we're going to do a couple more examples of fruit sins, discover the root sin, then what does repentance and belief look like for us as believers? So let me pray for us, and we'll be dismissed. Jesus, I'm encouraged when I see your words in John 6, when you said that the work of God is to believe in the one he sent. That encourages me because that's something that I can do. When I look at all of the Old Testament rules and regulations that you laid before your people, that's overwhelming to think of trying to keep all of those things. But as your people on this side of the cross, all you call us to is to believe what's true about you, what's true about God, and then live in light of that. And I pray that you would keep teaching me, keep teaching my friends in this room, teach us how to recognize not just the fruit sin, but to see underneath what we don't believe about God, what's at the root, the heart idolatry, so that we might repent of that and then walk in faith to what the Holy Spirit would have us do. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.